Testing. Good morning. Whether you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary or online, whether the season of Advent is new to you or a much-loved tradition, we welcome you to St. John's Lutheran Church. We welcome you as we point together towards something big and important, beyond ourselves, the birth of Christ and the coming of the kingdom of God. We are grateful for all the ways we can remember and care for others, including giving gifts to help families at community services for children. If you have taken a tag from the giving tree and have purchased a gift card, please remember to write on the card how much it's worth. All gifts for the giving tree and community services for children are now due. If you haven't turned yours in yet, please make arrangements with Barbara to get it to her at your earliest convenience. She needs to take them in this week. This Wednesday, we have a supper at 6 p.m. and quiet, reflective Blue Christmas worship service at 6:45. Please encourage your friends in the community who might appreciate a meal and good company to join us for supper. Please encourage anyone who needs time to remember a loved one, to seek healing, and to reflect to join us for worship. Our services next Sunday will include our fourth Sunday of Advent worship at 9:30 a.m., our Christmas Eve worship service at 5 p.m., then on Monday morning, Christmas morning, we will gather for worship at 9:30 a.m. Join us on New Year's Eve day for our Sunday morning worship at 9:30, which will include a Christmas hymn sing. Today will be a fun and filled one for us. After worship, we have a fellowship hour. We decorate our chrismon tree. The tree is up, but we need to decorate it after church today. And we have a chance to learn more about our new website. So please plan on staying after worship for a happy time together.
Lighting candles reminds us that small amounts of light add up together to make a much brighter light, strong light enough to dispel dreary gloom. So for our Advent wreath, we have two candles burning, the first reminding us that we can look for Christ from the warmth of our homes, that we can look for Christ as love, a beloved guest on the way to spend time with us. The second candle reminds us of another part of creation, of the earth itself, soil through which plants send down their roots and provide minerals and water. We thought of Christ as love arose growing up from the earth. And then what part of creation is left? We talked about home, we talked about the earth. Today's candle, the third one, reminds us of space stretched out before us, of the heavens above. We think of stars in the night sky, looking for another brighter star to join them. We think of looking for Christ as love, the star, on the way to bring light to the thick night sky. So let's stand and sing together the third verse of People Look East as we anticipate Christ's light gathering strength in the world. And after we stand and sing, we will remain standing for confession and forgiveness. Let us pray. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who opens the heavens and draws near to us with salvation.
Amen.
God is patient and merciful, desiring all to come to repentance. Trusting this promise of grace, let us confess our sin. Everlasting God, you love justice and you hate wrongdoing. We confess the fear, greed, and self-centeredness that make us reluctant to work against oppression. We are complicit in systems of exploitation. We choose comfort over courage. We are careless with creation's bounty. Look upon us with mercy. Turn our hearts again to you. Make us glad to do your will and to walk in your ways for the sake of our waiting world. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. God clothes you with the garments of salvation and covers you with robes of righteousness. In tender compassion, Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. God's covenant is eternal, and God's blessing rests upon us all.
Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up the wills of your faithful people, Lord God, and open our ears to the words of your prophets, that, anointed by your Spirit, we may testify to your light, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with garland, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in the spring up, so the Lord God will cause the righteousness and praise to spring up before the nations. The word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
This morning's psalm is Psalm 126. We'll read responsively. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then were we like those who dream. Then with our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy, then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad indeed. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the waterless maiden. Those who sowed with tears will reap the songs of joy. Those who toiled weaving, carrying the seed, will come home again with joy, shouldering their sheaves.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise the words of the prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Last week, as we usually do on the second Sunday of Advent, we spent some time with John the Baptist. We got a look at John's ministry from the perspective of the Gospel of Mark. We heard that John was preparing the way for Jesus and the coming kingdom of God by removing obstacles for people. He made it easier for people to seek and find forgiveness. We wondered how we might help prepare the way for others and for ourselves by removing obstacles in our own times and places. Today, the third Sunday of Advent in the year of Mark, we get another look at John the Baptist, this time from the perspective of the Gospel of John. Listen and see what John the Baptist might have to say to us today about preparing the way for Jesus and the coming kingdom of God. Let's stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to John. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord. Before we get to John the Baptist, let me ask you two questions. How many of you have ever heard of Martin Luther King Jr.? Okay, right, a lot of you have. Let's see, how many of you have ever heard about Bayard Rustin? No? Well, depending on the circles that you are in, Bayard Rustin isn't exactly a household name. Maybe you are like I am. Even though I know that the civil rights movement in America would never have happened without all the people who prepared the way, who sacrificed, who worked hard for it, it's easier for me to remember Martin Luther King Jr. He ended up standing at the forefront of the movement. I have to go back and reread some history to remember the names of others who also helped to define and lead the movement. This week, I went looking again at that history and came across the names of several key people who helped King develop his philosophy and commitment to nonviolent resistance. One of them was Bayard Rustin, a Black gay man born in 1912 in Westchester, PA. Keep in mind that the Montgomery bus boycott, which propelled young Martin Luther King Jr. into leadership, took place in 1955 through 1956. Long before that, in 1942, Rustin was one of the people who helped organize CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality, an organization that would later play a key role in the civil rights movement. Long before that, in 1947, Rustin participated in CORE's organized bus rides, pairing Black and white passengers riding together on interstate buses. Those rides would become the model for the 1961 Freedom Rides of the Civil Rights Movement. Long before the Montgomery bus boycott, and long before Martin Luther King visited, Rustin visited India in 1948 to learn more about Mahatma Gandhi and the methods of nonviolent resistance to oppression. So when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the Montgomery bus and her action set off the Montgomery bus boycott, Bayard Rustin was well positioned to bring his knowledge, his organizing skills, and his deep commitment to nonviolence to the effort in Montgomery. He was well positioned to be one of the people who helped King move beyond an academic understanding of Gandhi's methods. I mean, King had read about Gandhi in graduate school, but hadn't had any experience applying them. Rustin had. Rustin was able to help King move to a deep and abiding commitment to and ability to use nonviolent methods in the civil rights struggle. From being a key advisor early on in King's career, Rustin went on and assisted the movement in many ways. He was one of the key organizers of the March on Washington in 1963. As a gay man in that era, however, he was often kept intentionally in the background, out of the limelight because of his sexual orientation. I wonder what Rustin and others who made significant contributions to the civil rights movement would have said if they had been asked, "Are you the one? Are you the person who should stand at the forefront? Are you the one, the person with a name everyone should remember? Are you the person for whom monuments should be built and holidays celebrated?" Rustin and many others like him would have probably said, "No, no, it's not about me." And if people had asked, as the leaders from Jerusalem asked John the Baptist, "Well, if it's not about you, then who are you? What gives you the authority, the audacity to do what you were doing?" Rustin would probably have said, "I'm laying groundwork for the movement. I am helping to prepare the way for something big and wonderful, for people everywhere in America, regardless of their skin color, to live and flourish in freedom." Rustin's very important work behind the scenes and headlines makes me think of John the Baptist in our gospel lesson today. When the priests and Levites show up and ask if he is one of the greats, John is clear about his identity and purpose. As we read in the story, the leaders from Jerusalem ask, "Are you the Messiah?" "No," John says, "it's not about me." "Are you Elijah?" "No, it's not about me." "Are you the prophet?" "No, I've already told you, it's not about me." Just as an aside, you would think John the Baptist is a 2-year-old. He says no a lot. But that's an aside. The leaders from Jerusalem go on to ask another logical question. "Well, if you're not one of the greats, then who are you?" And John the Baptist gives them another straightforward answer. "I am the one preparing the way." John has the gift, the clarity of knowing his own identity and purpose. He agrees with the writer of John's gospel, who has already told us, his readers, who John is and what his purpose is. Here is the gospel writer's description of John. "There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light." When John answers his questioners and says, "I am not, it's not about me," we know he is right. He is not the Messiah, Elijah, or the prophet. He is not the one to whom everyone should be pointing and looking. He is, however, a person who points to the light. He is one who points others to Jesus. Now, I suspect knowing he was not the one was a relief to John. John can say to himself, "I am not the one who has to be the center of attention. I am not the one who is the beginning and the end. I am not the one on whom all responsibility finally rests. I am not the solution to everyone's problem." I suspect knowing his purpose was also good for John. He could say to himself, "But I do clearly know my mission. I do know what I am doing. I am preparing the ground. I can give what I have to give. I don't have to be the light, but I can point others to the light, Jesus, God's light in the world." Thinking about Bayard Rustin, who stayed out of the limelight, and John the Baptist, who insisted that he was not the Messiah, makes me want to ask myself and all of us some questions. What kind of relief and freedom can we feel and live into if we are clear about our own identity and are able to say no, as John the Baptist did? "No, I am not the person in control. God's light, not my own opinions and preferences, can show us the way. No, I am not the person who has to prove myself to anybody. God's light stands for itself. No, I am not the person who has to do all the work or work alone. Others are working with me, pointing to the light, so everything doesn't depend on me. And no, I am not a person who has to work even when I am tired and empty. The light is strong enough to shine on its own." Second question. What might we also be like when we are clear about our own purpose, as John was clear about his? What might we be like when we say yes to that purpose? "Yes, I am the person who prepares the way for others to believe in Jesus. Yes, when I serve at the food pantry, I point to Christ who fed the hungry. Yes, when I offer comfort and care, I point to Christ who healed the sick. Yes, when I pick up the phone and listen, I point to Christ. When I pray for and work for justice and freedom, I point to Christ When I care for my family and friends, I point to Christ. Yes, when I make beautiful music and prepare beautiful spaces, I point to Christ. I bet that you can think of a lot more ways that we each say yes and point to the light. Finally, we get to trust in Christ, who is also clear about his own purpose and identity, who could and did say, "Yes, I am. I am the light. I am the light of the world, and I will help you see how to love and care for each other. I am God's light, and I will help you see how to work for the light of justice and freedom. I am God's light. And the shadows of sickness and fatigue, the shadows of doubt and an uncertain future, the shadows of hatred and violence will not overcome it." Like Bayard Rustin, like so many others who have prepared the way for good things to happen in the world, like John the Baptist who prepared the way for Jesus, may God help us feel unburdened and relieved when we can say, "No, it's not about me." May God give us clear purpose and resolve when we point not to ourselves, but to Christ, who is the light of the world. Now, speaking of Jesus as the light of the world, we're going to sing an old hymn together in a new way. If you will look at the back of the announcements page, you will find "Jesus, the Light of the World." It's from the new Lutheran hymnal, "All Creation Sings." The words are actually familiar to us, the first verse of a Christmas hymn, "Hark, the Herald Angels Sing." The response, "Jesus, the Light of the World," has been added after each phrase, and a refrain has been added after each verse. So Mike and the choir are going to sing and play the first verse for us. Listen for the emphatic and enthusiastic insistence that Jesus is the light of the world. And then, after they've sung it for us once, we'll stand and sing together. We'll be like Bayard Rustin and John the Baptist, people who were committed to Jesus, who brings the beautiful light of justice and freedom into the world. Stand and sing together. Thank you. with the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. Please be seated for prayer.
Please remember the following people in your prayers this week: Christopher, Candace, Dylan, Barb and Steve, Mark, Lynn, Shirley, Paul, Janice, Otto, Dick, Donald, Pastor Paul, Pastor Jerry, Jen, Brian, John, Pat and Conrad, Lucille and Butch, Carol, Charlene, Debbie, Bruce, Dottie, Janet, Robert, Asa, Tom, Mike, Susan, Gloria, Marv, Jonathan, Chris, Joe, and John. With the hope and expectation, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all who await God's day of restoration. Fill our mouths with laughter and our tongues with shouts of joy as we bear witness to the great things you have done. Give your church a spirit of gladness as we gather and we are sent. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Let the trees of the field sing your praise. Protect forests, orchards, rainforests, and all wooded areas from disease and deforestation. Keep us grateful for their gifts of oxygen, food, shade, and shelter. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You love justice and promise your favor to those who are oppressed, brokenhearted, and incarcerated. Grant wisdom and compassion to those who work for public safety and all who work within prisons, jails, and courts, that mercy may increase and violence wither away. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Give us strength to pray for our world without ceasing and provoke us toward love and good deeds for all who are in need. Provide for all without adequate housing, food, employment, or access to health care. Empower us as helpers and advocates. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Open our hearts to those who serve as truth tellers in our church and in our society. Bless leaders in church and society in their task of proclamation. Amplify voices of peacemakers, advocates, and especially those whose voices are ignored or marginalized. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
For peace among nations, especially for the leaders of Israel and Hamas, and for Russia and Ukraine, that they may find a way to move toward peace. For victims of terrorist attacks in Pakistan, for educators, administrators, and all leaders of educational institutions, merciful God,
receive our prayer.
For those who are sick, many of us who are not here today who are sick, for areas dealing with suffering due to climate change and for policies that protect environmental concerns, for relief and rebuilding efforts following tornadoes in Tennessee, for all who are celebrating and making preparation for winter holidays, merciful God,
receive our prayer.
With gratitude, we rejoice in the saints who witnessed to your life in all circumstances, and whom your spirit was not quenched, even in death. Through them, teach us always to hold fast to what is good. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Listen to these and all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy.
Amen.
Let us point not to our own gloom, but to the light. Let us point not to ourselves, but to Christ. Let us, as John the Baptist did, introduce others to God's presence in the world by bringing our offerings to God, our time, our friendships, our creativity, and our financial resources. Let us bring our gifts to God as we stand and sing our offering song. Let us pray. God, our provider, by your merciful hand, abundance springs up from the earth. Receive and bless these gifts of your own bounty. Let them be a sign of your steadfast love and faithfulness for all people, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, blessed are you from the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your own Son, Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. In this meal, righteousness and peace meet together. Come. Take your place at the table. Let us pray. Gracious God, in bread and cup, you have revealed your glory for all people to see together. Nourished by this meal, send us out to proclaim your good news of liberation and release brought to birth in Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The God of peace bless you, the love of Christ sustain you in hope, and the anointing of the Spirit remain upon you now and forever.
Go in peace, keep awake. Thanks be to God.